Chapter 69. Trouble at the Golden Chicken Range. At the Golden Chicken Range, when Jiang Ziya heard about the big army before them, he ordered his troops to halt their advance. They camped before the mountain. He sat alone in his tent, thinking. How strange. There have been 36 invasions already. Counting on his fingers, he discovered that Zhang Shan was really only the 35th. This one then was really the 36th. Kong Xuan asked his generals. Who would like to challenge for the first combat?
I would.
Answered Chen Geng, the vanguard general. With the approval of Kong Xuan, Chen Geng rode down from the mountain and challenged the Zhou forces. By order of Jiang Ziya, Huang Tianhua rode out on his jade unicorn and saw a general holding a halberd. The general shouted loudly to him. Who are you, you rebel? I'm Huang Tianhua, vanguard general under Commander Jiang. Tell me your name so that I can put it in the record book. You are but a small chick. How dare you fight with a great general of the Imperial Army? Chen Geng said furiously. He attacked Huang Tianhua, and Huang met him with his two hammers. In 30 rounds, Huang Tianhua turned tail and ran away. Chen Geng pursued him. Huang took out a fire dragon javelin, threw it at Chen, and knocked him from his horse. Huang turned back and cut Chen Geng's head off. He then returned in victory. Delighted at his general's success, Jiang Ziya took up a pen, intending to record his merit, but when he dipped the pen in the ink slab, the nib dropped off. Jiang Ziya said not a word at the inauspicious omen. It seemed that Huang Tianhua would also lose his head soon, and this would be high fast merit achieved. Kong Xuan smiled carelessly at the loss of Chen Geng. He thought to himself, that's no pity. He had no talent anyway. The next day, Kong Xuan sent General Sun He out to challenge the Zhou army. With the approval of Jiang Ziya, Wu Ji went to answer the challenge. He saw a general, dressed in a pink robe and gold armor, holding a cutlass. The general shouted loudly to him. Who's that coming? I'm Wu Ji, vanguard general under Commander Jiang. Jiang was an old fisherman, and you were a woodcutter. You two make a good pair. Sun He laughed sarcastically. Wu Ji swore angrily. You bastard. How dare you? He stabbed at Sun He with his lance, but the latter checked him with his cutlass. After 30 rounds, Wu Ji ran away as if defeated. Su He thought of him as only a common woodcutter, not a skilled general, but as he pursued him at high speed, Wu Ji suddenly stopped his horse and stabbed him in the breast. Sun was cut down from his horse. Wu Ji's victory excited Ne Jia. He scratched his ears and cheeks. He was eager for a fight. Kong Xuan sighed when he received the report of Sun He's death. He said to his generals, I had hoped that you would all achieve merit, but now two generals have lost their lives. Who would like to go and fight the next? Gao Jineng answered the call. He mounted his horse and holding a spear and ran out to the front. He was met by Ne Jia. No hurry. Take it easy, Ne Jia. Gao Jineng shouted. If you know me, why don't you dismount and surrender? Ne Jia said happily. I am more than pleased to meet you as I know you are skilled in magic. Tell me your name so that I may record it in the book. Ne Jia said roughly. In a great rage, Gao Jineng stabbed at Ne Jia's heart. A fierce battle began. Fearing that Ne Jia might use his magic, Gao Jineng turned and ran away, but Ne Jia, determined to win the day, would not give him up. He took out his universal ring and threw it at Gao Jineng. Gao had no time to open his bag full of centipedes and wasps. He was wounded in the shoulder and ran back to the camp. Ne Jia was disappointed at his failure to take Gao captive or to cut off his head. Kong Xuan said nothing but simply treated Gao's wound with medicine. The next day he appeared personally on the battlefield demanding Jiang Ziya. Jiang rode out on his nondescript horse. Kong was dressed in gold armor and rode on a red horse. He held a large cutlass and 5 rays of light green, yellow, red, white, and black soared up from his back. Jiang became suspicious. Kongshan rode forward and asked, "Is that Jiang Ziya?"
"Yes,"
Commander Jiang replied. "You were once a minister of the Sheng. Why have you rebelled?"
"By order of His Majesty, I've come with a great army. You may keep your land if you withdraw, but if you don't, I'll level your cities. The will of heaven is subject to change, and the virtuous will always win out. Don't you see how cruel King Zhou is? Every heart has turned to us. We'll heartily welcome you if you join us, General."
Jiang Ziya replied, "Don't you think it's against the will of heaven to offend His Majesty?"
Kongshun yelled. He spurred his horse forward to attack Jiang Ziya with his cutlass.
Hong Jin ran out to meet him.
"Don't be so rude, Kongshun. Here I come."
Kongshun cursed. "You damned rebel. Dare you come to meet me? The 800 nobles have sided with us. What can you do all alone?"
Kongshan wrathfully attacked Hong Jin. After a few rounds, Hong Jin planted his flag in the ground, moved his cutlass horizontally, and turned the flag into a door. When Hong Jin tried to enter the door, Kongshan burst into laughter. "That pearl's worth no more than a grain of rice." He turned around and swept the yellow beam of light from his back towards Hong Jin, who disappeared in a flash. Only his horse was left behind. Kongshun then turned towards Jiang Ziya, who met the attack with his sword. Deng Jiogong rushed over to help. After 15 rounds, Jiang took out his staff for beating gods and threw it at Kongshun, but the staff disappeared in Kong's beam of red light. Jiang Ziya quickly ordered his troops to withdraw, and both sides returned to their camps. Back in his tent, Jiang Ziya pondered over the problem. His 5 rays of light are somewhat like the 5 elements, but nothing more is known about him. What shall I do now? He then thought up a plan. Having won today, he may relax vigilance tonight. I'll set up a surprise attack and then see what we can do. Calling in his generals, he ordered, "Nijia, you attack the front camp. Huang Tianhua, you attack from the left. And Thunderbolt, you go in from the right. We've got to destroy his confidence first." In his own camp, Kongshan flashed his beams and Hong Jin fell to the floor, unconscious. He was locked up in the back camp. Kongshan was about to retire when a sudden wind whipped through the flags. Kongshan made a quick prediction with his fingers and found out what was going on. He ordered his generals to prepare for the attack. "Gao Jineng, you ambush them from the left camp, and Zhou Xin, you wait at the door of the right camp. Jiang Ziya will attack us tonight, but he won't come himself." The 3 generals from West Qi climbed the mountain after dark and at the second watch, attacked King Zhou's army. Nijia tried to break into the central camp, and Kongshan rode out to meet him. Kongshan laughed. "Nijia, you'll be my captive tonight." Nijia did not know how terrible Kongshan was. He swore at him, "I'll take care of you all right." As Nijia fought with Kongshan, Thunderbolt flew over to attack Zhou Xin. Zhou Xin was in the right camp. He found it difficult to meet the attack from above, for he could not see clearly in the darkness. Before long, he was knocked heavily on the head. He died at once, his skull smashed into pieces. Thunderbolt then flew to the central camp to help Nijia, but Kongshan took him at once with his yellow beam. Nijia had no time to run away, for Kongshan suddenly turned and swept the white light toward him. Huang Tianhua forced his way into the left camp. He met Gao Jineng, and the two fought without saying a word. Huang Tianhua played his hammers swiftly, and Gao Jineng had to run away. Huang Tianhua was unwilling to let him go. He patted his jade unicorn to give chase. Gao Jineng opened his bag full of centipedes and wasps. Huang Tianhua defended himself by playing his 2 hammers, but the eyes of his jade unicorn were seriously stung. The jade unicorn screamed in pain, reared up on its hind legs, and threw Huang down from the saddle. He fell to the ground and was stabbed by Gao Jineng.
The battle lasted through the night. Corpses lay piled on the mountain, and the grass was stained red with blood. Kongshan locked up his prisoners in the back camp and sat down to record Gao Jinan's merit. He told his soldiers to hand Huang Tianhua's head on a pole to warn the enemy. Jiang Ziya could not sleep that night with all the noise on the mountain. At dawn, it was reported that the three generals were all defeated. The head of Huang Tianhua is on a pole and the two other generals are missing. Jiang Ziya was filled with dread, and Huang Feihu lamented bitterly. "Oh, my son! What good was your talent after all? You couldn't even get anything from the Shang dynasty." The other generals also wept at their loss. Huang Feihu was so affected that he lost his senses. Jiang Ziya was worried and said nothing. "General Huang, don't go on so. Your boy's name will be recorded in history. Gao Jinan has a bag of magic wasps and centipedes. I suggest you go and see Chong Heihu and ask him to take care of these insects with his magic hawks." Nan Gong Kuo said to comfort him. Huang Feihu immediately went to see Jiang Ziya. "I would like to go and see Chong Heihu. He can deal with Gao Jinan. I await your approval." Jiang Ziya agreed to his proposal. Huang Feihu traveled by day and rested by night. When he got to Mount Flying Phoenix, he urged his divine ox up the mountain and saw three generals engaged in battle. Each held a different weapon, a long-handled fork, a bronze hammer, and a silver talon with five claws. First the fork and the talon fought the hammer, then the hammer and the fork fought the talon. The generals laughing and making fun of each other. They're amusing themselves in such a funny way. I'll ask who they are. Huang Feihu thought to himself. As he moved forward, the general with the fork looked over at him. Huang had the eyes of a pink phoenix and thick, bushy eyebrows. He was wearing a prince's robe and also sat astride a divine rainbow ox. The general yelled, "Brothers, stop!" He then bowed and greeted Huang Feihu. "Prince Huang Feihu." "Yes, that's right. How do you know me, general?" Huang asked. All three dismounted and knelt on the ground. "I can tell from your appearance. We are glad to meet you." They then ushered him to their tent on the summit. Having taken their seats, Huang Feihu asked, "Why were you fighting one another?" "To pass our time." They replied, "May I know your honorable names?" "My name is Wen Ping. He's Tsu Ying, and this is Jiang Xiong. May I ask where you are going?" Huang Feihu told them about the expedition and his son's death. He then added, "I'm going to ask General Cheng Heihu to deal with Gao Jinan. I'm afraid Cheng Heihu might be unwilling to go with you." Wen Ping said, "How do you know?" Huang Feihu asked. "He's training his troops now. He'll soon attack Chintang Pass to meet the nobles at Mengjin. If he goes with you, he'll be delayed." Wen Ping concluded, "I don't think so. Though Brother Wen has made a good point, Chong Heihu must wait in Mengjin for King Wu before he can take any action. Your Highness may stay here overnight, and the three of us will go with you to see him tomorrow. I don't think he will turn us down," Sui Yina said. The next morning, the four started out for Cheng City. When they arrived, they asked the Gatamun to report to Chong Heihu that the three generals from Mount Flying Phoenix wanted to see him. When admitted, Qi Ying said, "Prince Huang Feihu is waiting outside the gate." Chong Heihu hurried to welcome Huang Feihu at the stone steps and said, "Excuse me, Your Highness. I failed to meet you in the proper place because I didn't know of your arrival. I'm pleased to have the honor of meeting you here." Huang Feihu replied. After they had all taken their seats, Wen Ping explained the purpose of their visit. "If you enter Chintang Pass first, you'll still have to wait for King Wu. In my opinion, we should take care of Gao Jinan so that Jiang Ziya's forces can continue onward. We can then go back to break through Chintang Pass." Sui Ying proposed. "If that be so, we'll start out tomorrow. I'll tell Chong Yingluan to prepare the troops.
Chung Hei-hu entertained his guests, and they left early the next morning. When they arrived at the Golden Chicken Range, Jiang Ziya expressed his thanks and then said, "Kongshan is causing so many problems, we've had to trouble you to come here. Please do whatever you can." After expressing his thanks, Chung Hei-hu stood up and said to Jiang Ziya, "Would you please take me to see His Highness King Wu?" Jiang Ziya led him to the back camp to see the king. After the greetings were over, Chung Hei-hu said, "Your Highness, you have acted according to the will of heaven. How dare Kongshan try to stop the advance of our army? He's only committing suicide. It seems to me that heaven is not with us at present. Why else would we face such big obstacles? Don't you think I should withdraw and ask for forgiveness?" King Wu asked. "No, that won't do, Your Highness. Don't discourage all the nobles just because of Kongshan, and don't disappoint your generals and soldiers." Chung Hei-hu said sincerely. King Wu entertained Chung Hei-hu, and afterwards, Jiang Ziya invited him and the other three generals to dinner in his tent. The next day, Chung Hei-hu rode out on his fiery-eyed monster, with Wen Ping, Cui Ying, and Jiang Xiong flanking him on both sides. They demanded to see Gao Jinang. By order of Kongshan, Gao Jinang rode out to meet them. He yelled, "You are a rebel from the north. Why have you come here to help West Qi? I'll get you all anyway. You damned fool. Did you murder General Huang Tianhua? Even Nijia and Thunderbolt are in our hands. What can you do about it?" Gao Jinang yelled back. He attacked Chung Hei-hu with his lance, and Chong met the assault with his axes. After a few rounds, Wen Ping, Cui Ying, and Jiang Xiong all joined in. They surrounded their enemy in a circle. Hearing the beating of drums, Jiang Ziya said to Huang Feihu, "Chung Hei-hu has come at your request. Go and give him a hand." Prince Huang Feihu got on his ox and rushed out of the camp, shouting, "Marquis Chung, here I come to get that assassin. What was the result of this fresh attack? Please read the next chapter to find out."